नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, इन द मॉर्निंग यू हैव विटनेस्ड द वर्ल्ड ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर. नाउ टुडे इन द आफ्टरनून वी विल सी अबाउट एटॉमिक एनर्जी. नाउ दीज टू टॉपिक्स आर देयर फॉर अवर नेशनल लेवल कैंप इन ICS सेक्शन. Of course, we are not going to cover syllabus as such. Remember, these lectures are just like supporting material for you. You people should get enriched. You should get some kind of the sense of what is going on in our country in these two fields. And these things should come to you directly from the scientist community. This is the entire purpose of this lecture series. So in the morning you had agriculture lecture, and now we will commence the lecture series on atomic energy. So for this we have two working scientists. In fact, we are very much lucky, it is our privilege that you get a chance to interact, to listen to two working scientists from one of the premier research institute in India in the field of atomic energy, and that is Bhabha Atomic Research Center, or BARC. As you know, BARC is situated in Mumbai, and you will be listening to the two scientists working in this institute today. So without wasting much time, without having gap between you and the scientist, I first of all invite Dr. Vinod Kumar Aswal. I will introduce Vinod Kumar Aswal ji. Aswal ji, namaste. Bahut bahut swagat aapka.
Namaste.
Aur बड़ी बेसब्री से इंतजार है आपके विचारों का और आपके मार्गदर्शन का इन सभी बच्चों को जो अभी नेक्स्ट संडे ही नेशनल लेवल कैंप में हमसे जुड़ेंगे. तो विनोद कुमार आसवाल जी का बहुत बहुत स्वागत. और इन ब्रीफ आई जस्ट गिव हिज इंट्रोडक्शन टू ऑल ऑफ यू. Dr. Vinod Kumar Aswal sir is presently working as head of small angle scattering section, solid state physics division at Bhabha Atomic Research Center, Mumbai. He is also professor, Homi Bhabha National Institute, Mumbai. He is working as a scientist at BARC since 1993. He did his MSc in physics from IIT Mumbai, PhD from Mumbai University, and postdoctorate from Paul Schrader Institute, Switzerland. Dr. Aswal is expert in the field of small angle neutron scattering, and exactly this is the topic on which he will guide us: neutron scattering and its applications. So he is expert in this field, and of course, he has also been involved in popularizing the usage of this technology, these facilities, among many university researchers. Dr. Aswal is recipient of number of awards. They include IUMRS Young Research Award, IPA Best Thesis Award, IPA Satyamurthy Young Scientist Award, then DIE SSPS 2007 Young Achiever Award, DIE Scientific and Technical Excellence Award, DIE Group Achievement Award, DIE SRC Outstanding Investigator Award, Homi Bhabha Science and Technology Award, and many more of this kind. He has been listed in the world's top 2%. Remember, he has been listed, I am repeating, he has been listed in the world's top 2% of the most cited scientists by Stanford University. He has published more than 400 research papers in journals, having H index of 51. Friends, just Google after the lecture, just Google what is H index. And you will find that if H index is say 40, then that scientist and his contribution is considered as outstanding in the world scientist community. And we are fortunate to have such a great scientist among us today, that Dr. V.K. Aswal and his research papers have H index as 51. Remember 51. And the total citations are around 12,000. So, हम स्वागत करते हैं वीके आसवाल जी का तहे दिल से. और मुझे बड़ी ये अभी वी आर वेटिंग एक्चुअली ईगरली टू लिसन टू हिम. सो आई इनवाइट डॉक्टर विनोद कुमार आसवाल फॉर हिज प्रेजेंटेशन एंड गाइडेंस ऑन न्यूट्रॉन स्कैटरिंग एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशंस. डॉक्टर आसवाल.
धन्यवाद हेमंत जी. ये मेरा सौभाग्य है कि आपने मुझे अपॉर्चुनिटी दिया बच्चों से इंटरेक्ट करने के लिए. और जो आज का आपने टॉपिक रखा है एटॉमिक एनर्जी, और न्यूट्रॉन स्कैटरिंग इज पार्ट ऑफ एटॉमिक एनर्जी, एंड द चिल्ड्रन विल लर्न इन दिस लेक्चर दैट हाउ यूजफुल दिस स्कैटरिंग टेक्निक इज, पर्टिकुलरली फॉर मटेरियल करेक्टराइजेशन. And once you characterize materials, then you can predict their properties for the its application or its uses. And this is the photograph of two reactors where we do neutron scattering experiments in India. So this is the recent one, Dhruva, and this is Cyrus. So what you are going to learn in this lecture is very basics of neutron scattering. As such, it's a very vast field. But I will try to do justice in 25 minutes so that you can understand basics of this technique. So for that, the outline is as follows. So I will start with what is a scattering experiment, then why neutron is unique probe. So as a probe, you can use different methods like X-ray, electron, but particularly why neutron is unique, so that I will cover. And then if you want to do neutron scattering in India, where is the place? And then, as the title of the lecture says, I will go to the application of neutron scattering, and I will show some examples, and finally the take home message you will carry with you. So what is a scattering experiment? So scattering experiments, you need to have a source first. This source could be of neutron, X-ray and light, because these are the radiations which can see the minute of the material. So minute means atoms and molecules. So if you use these kind of radiations like neutron, X-ray and light, and allow them to fall on the sample, and once they fall on the samples, so they will see, they can see, we cannot see what is inside the material because they are so minute, of the order of angstrom or nanometer. But these radiation, they can see what is there inside the material. And after seeing those atoms and molecules, they will accordingly scatter. So once they scatter, so what you do is you measure this scattering intensity on the detector as a function of scattering angle. So this is incident beam, and this will be beam going to the detector. So scattering beam. So how do you do a scattering experiments? You start with sample of interest where you want to see the material properties. It could be solid or liquid. So in the case of solid, you will make it in the pellet form, and the liquid you will put in a quartz cell for which neutrons have a very good transmission, more than 95%. And then you measure, as I said, intensity as a function of a scattering angle. So you will get some pattern, and this pattern is what neutron or X-ray has seen from the sample. So once you have this pattern, what do you get from this pattern? So basically, from this pattern, you can get two kind of information. One is structure and another is dynamics. Structure means how these atoms, molecules, which are very, very small, are arranged within the material. And how do you get this information? This you get by elastic scattering experiments. So as I said, in scattering experiments, your radiation is falling on the sample and you are measuring scattering intensity as a function of angle. But when you talk about elastic scattering, the energy of your scatter neutron is same as incident neutron. So once that is same and you measure intensity as a function of angle, then it is called elastic scattering experiments. And from this, you get information about the structure of the sample. So how these atoms, molecules are arranged inside the material. And if you want to get the information about dynamics, how these atoms, molecules are moving inside the material, then you make use of inelastic scattering experiment. In this case, what you do is you look at the energy of the scattered neutron, which is not same as was in the case of elastic scattering. You see either energy gain or lost by the neutron. And that will look at the information taken by the neutron when the atoms, molecules are moving. So from this, you can get the information about dynamics. And once you know the structure and dynamics, you can predict the property of the material or you can improve the property of material. Why this is so important? Because if you see 1994 Nobel Prize, it was given to Professor Sull from USA and Professor Brockhaus from Canada for their contribution to neutron scattering. And they got it because Professor Sull worked on making use of neutron to find the structure in wide range of material. And Professor Brockhaus got this Nobel Prize for making use of neutron to look at the dynamics in the system. Dynamics means how the atoms move, and structure means how the atoms are arranged in the material. So why neutron? So as I said, you can also do X-ray or electron scattering, but why neutron is unique proof? So what you should know is first is how the neutrons are produced. And many of you may be knowing that to produce neuton, there is a famous reaction called fission reaction. So what happens in case of fission reaction? A neutron is absorbed by heavy nuclei like uranium. And once it absorbs this, then it gets splitted into two parts. And in addition to that, there are a number of neutrons produced from 2 to 3. And then what is important is lot of energy is produced. And this energy, as Mr. Hemant was saying, that is produced to get atomic energy. So if you want to make a reactor or a source of energy from nuclear, so it is this energy which is used. Lots of energy is produced. But for this part of lectures, what we are interested are about the neutrons. So you see, when you have one nuclei splitting into two nuclei or undergoing nuclear fission, you produce also neutrons. And we make use of these neutrons for neutron scattering. And this reaction was discovered by Professor Lise Meitner, who was a physicist, in collaboration with Professor Otto Hahn, who was a chemist. And they discovered this reaction in 1939. And since all nuclear reactions, they involve a lot of energy. And as I said, that's what you make use of atomic energy when you control it. And if you don't control it, you may be knowing that it will be a bomb. But at the same time, for research purpose, what you make is use of these neutrons, which, as I said, will also have very high energy. So around 1 million electron volt. And when you want to do scattering experiments, you really need very low energy neutrons. So how do you do that for? For that, you use your moderators like water. Water is very good moderator because neutron can go elastic collision with hydrogen nuclei and lose their energy. So, and from that thermal energy, you can go from 15 to 200 milli electron volt. So when you have fission reactions, they are a million electron volt, 10 power 6 electron volt. And when you make use of a moderator, then it is very low energy, milli electron volt, 10 power minus 3 electron volt. And you can also make use of cold neutrons. For that, you make use of liquid hydrogen or G2 moderator at very low temperatures, around 25 K. And then you can go to low energy, 0.05 to 15 milli electron volt. And also for some purpose, when you want a little higher energy, then you make use of graphite moderator at higher temperature. So here the temperature is 2000 K. So in that case, you can go to energy 200 milli electron volt to 1 electron volt. So And these are the properties of neutrons. So when you produce neutrons, you know what is the mass. So mass is 1.675 into 10 plus minus 27 kg. Also proton is similar mass, but electron is about 2000 times less than this. And then interestingly, note that neutron doesn't have a charge. While proton has one electron charge, neutron doesn't have a charge. Neutron is a fermion, so it is a spin half particle. And interestingly, it is a small magnet, so it has a magnetic dipole moment. It doesn't have a charge, but has a magnetic moment. How is that possible? This is possible because it has an internal structure. So it is made of quarks. So it contains one up quark and two down quark. And up has 2/3 electron charge, and these have 1/3, 1/3. So total charge is zero. But because of distribution of charge, you can have an effective current, and hence it has a small magnetic dipole moment. And also what you should know is a free proton is unstable because neutron mass is slightly greater than proton. So what happens within a lifetime of 15 minutes, it converts into proton and electron and also antineutron. So it is an unstable particle unlike free proton. And then how does it interact? So as I said, when you want to see the information about the material at angstrom level, then you should know how these probes interact with the matter. And in the case of neutron, these are two kind of interaction it can have. So first is because it's a nuclear particle, it has an interaction with nucleus. So it doesn't look at the electron cloud. Mostly it looks at the nucleus, and which is very tiny as compared to atomic size. And second interaction is, as I said, it is a small magnet, so it can interact if your atom is magnet. If you have unpaired electrons in the atom, then it can also interact magnetically with the atom. So it has two kind of interaction. One is nuclear interaction and another is magnetic interaction. And then this is the formula for the energy, because it is so tiny that it also shows wave-like properties. It's not only particle-like but also wave-like. So if you want to have a scattering experiment and look at the structures, then it cannot be explained, because if your neutrons undergo scattering and interfere, you cannot explain this by particle like behavior. You have to assume this is like a wave like, and in that case your wavelength and energy are related by this formula. And your velocity, neutron has much smaller velocity than x-rays, where x-ray, you know, they move with the velocity of light, 3 lakhs kilometer per second, but in this case it will be just 4000 meter per second or 4 kilometer per second. So thermal neutron velocity and energy are very low compared to x-rays. So this is very important slide to show why neutrons are important for characterization of material. So first thing is that when you talk about thermal neutrons, they will have a wavelength which is equal to the atomic spacing in the material. So typical atomic spacing in the material is angstrom, that is 10 power minus 10 meter, and thermal neutron has that wavelength. So it means that you can see that length scale which is there in the material. Another important thing is, as I said, these thermal neutrons have the same energy like we get from the environment, KT energy, and that is also the energy with which the atoms vibrate. So if you want to look at the dynamics of the atoms, you can see with the neutron, because their energies are comparable. Then I said neutron is a small magnet, so you can look at magnetic structure and excitance, which you cannot see by any other probe. So if you want to look magnetic structure, only neutron is a unique probe. And another important thing is neutron see nucleus, unlike x-rays where your scattering is from the electron cloud. So neutron is seeing the nucleus. And in that case, you can see the light elements like hydrogen, lithium. These kind of elements are very difficult to see by X-rays, but with neutrons you can see. And one very important thing which I will cover, you can do the contrast variation with isotope. So you can make invisible visible and vice versa, only with neutrons, not with other techniques. And then neutron is a neutral, so its penetration power is high. So you can use bulk sample, which means that statistically you will get more accurate information. And also it's a non-destructive. So you can use your sample after the experiment, so they don't get destructive. And then where do you do the neutron scattering? So basically, first let's see how the neutron was produced. So it was produced, it was discovered by Chadwick in 1932. How it was produced was he bombarded beryllium nuclei with alpha particle, and then there were some new particles produced. There were many other researchers working that time, and they thought that it's just some electromagnetic radiation. But it was Chadwick who found out that this is not electromagnetic radiation, because its properties are very different than electromagnetic radiation, like gamma rays. Particularly, what he observed was when these unknown radiation at that time pass through a paraffin wax. Paraffin will have mostly hydrogen, and then he could see that the protons are coming out, and this will not happen with electromagnetic radiation like gamma. And that means that these are not electromagnetic radiation. These are some new particle, and that's what he called that these are neutrons. And for that, he got a Nobel Prize in 1935. Very important part of the nucleus now, as we all know. Then to have to do neutron scattering, you have to have a neutron sources. And as I already said, neutron sources, you have to have fission reactions, controlled fission reactions. And these all are called large-scale facilities. And to build these kind of neutron sources, you have to have advanced technology in your country. And if you see the distribution of these neutron sources worldwide, there will be only 20 places in the world where these sources are there. And we are proud country to have these sources in our place at Bhabha Atomic Research Center in Mumbai. So we are one of the 20 nations to have these kind of neutron sources where we can do the scattering experiments. And then this is the evolution of neutron sources which has taken place over the years in India. So we were as early as 1956 when Dr. Bhabha was there to build a research reactor, and it was 1 megawatt research reactors, and research reactor are characterized by how much flux you can produce of neutrons from this. So this was the amount of flux, 10 power 13 neutron per centimeter square per second. And this was in fact first in Asia in 1956, first in Asia built in India. And you can see Prime Minister at that time, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, having a look at the Apsara reactor from inside. And then came, this was built with the help of Canada-India reactor, actually, Cyrus, in 1960, much bigger than Apsara. It was 40 megawatt reactor and having this kind of flux, 6.5 into 10 power 13. And then Dhruva was completely indigenous, which was built in 1985. And now most of the neutron scattering experiments are centered around this reactor. And there are many applications. So I will be mostly talking about neutron scattering. But in the latter part, Dr. Joshi will cover other applications of neutron scattering, particularly health and agriculture. And this is the photograph of neutron scattering facility inside Dhruva reactors. So you can see they are massive. And this is typical instrument to look at the structure of a material. So you will have a neutron beam coming from the reactor. And this is called a monochromator drum, where you select a particular wavelength or energy, and then you will put up a sample here in the sample table. And then once they are scattered from the sample, then you will have a detector inside this shielding. So you have to put a lot of shielding to reduce the background, because as I said, neutrons are neutral, and whatever neutrons are here and there, they should not reach to the detector and counter as coming from the sample. So that's why you put a lot of shielding around the components you use in the neutron scattering. And this is a typical instrument to look at the dynamics of the sample. So again, monochromator inside this drum, then you will have a sample here. But you have to measure energy of the scattered neutron. So you put an analyzer here again. So there will be one more axis here, which was not there here. So one monochromator axis, second sample axis, and third will be analyzer. Now you put up analyzer, which will give you the energy of the scattered neutron, and then it will go to the detector. So it is called triple axis spectrometer to look the dynamics of the sample. And then what can you measure? Actually, as I said, you can measure structure and dynamics. why this is so important, because you can measure structure at different length scales, from very small, 1 to 1,000 angstroms. So very small means like atomic structures. Then you can look at the structure of polymers and proteins, and even higher structures like bacteria and viruses, you can look by neutron scattering. And then, of course, these kind of particles will have a dynamics in the system. So the bigger particle will have a smaller dimension. So the time scales will be 10^-6 seconds, that is microsecond time scale. They will move very slowly. And the smaller one, like atoms, molecules in the solids, liquids, they move very faster. So their time scale will be of the order of femto. Femto means 10^-15 seconds. So this is time scale you can measure from 10^-6 to 10^-7 seconds, which are either otherwise very, very small to be measured. And also length scales, very small length scale. 1 angstrom, as I said, 10^10 meter, that you can measure by this thing. So wide range of materials and in wide range of disciplines. And then this is applications where you can make use of neutron scattering. So as I already said, crystal structure, how the atoms are distributed in the material, because that is what will decide final property of this material. And then it's not how the atoms are seated, but if those atoms are magnetic and their moments, how they are aligned actually. So this is called magnetic structure that with neutron you can only see. And then there will be some materials where like glass and liquids, where you don't have a long range order. So they are not arranged over a long range, but they are only arranged over a small range. They have a short range like glasses and liquids. And there also you can measure their structure. And then, as I said, even higher length scales like detergent molecules, polymers, collides, those kind of things, bacteria, viruses. So if you want to measure those structures, they can also be measured. So these are all different kind of structure. And also what is important, it's not only the bulk, but you can also look at interfaces in thin films and multi-layers by neutron scattering. And in the dynamics, you can look at the random motions in solids and liquids. How a protein is moving in a blood fluid, or a polymer in a polymer melt, and also periodic motion in solid. So once you have a structures and these atoms, they move collectively, and you want to see what kind of vibration frequencies they have. Those things again can be measured by neutron scattering. So you can see you can do a lot of things using neutron scattering, structure as well as dynamics. But what about the instrument which will measure all these things? So it is like a cricket team. I mean, you can see there are 11 players and each one has different roles. The same thing, if you want to measure these different things, you cannot have one instrument to measuring everything. So you need to have a set of different instruments, and that is what is done. So this shows a schematic of number of instruments that are working inside the reactor hall in Dhruva. So we will have about a dozen of different instruments looking at different aspects of material characterization. So we will have instruments in these categories. One is diffraction, where we look at atomic structures. Then small angle scattering, where we are looking at large structures. Then reflectometry, where we are looking thin films and multilayer. And these two techniques, inelastic scattering and quasi-elastic, these are to look at dynamics in the material. And who can make use of these facilities? So as already Mr. Hemant introduced, saying that we do help a lot of university researchers. And before that, we have a strong in-house research program. And also what we encourage is a student research project, particularly those who are in final years of BSc or in masters or even PhDs. So we encourage them to come to our place and learn about these techniques. So now in the remaining time, what I'm going to show you is some of the examples of neutron scattering. So one is looking for magnetic structure. So chemical structure you determine, and also magnetic structure by neutron scattering. So as I said, this you can do because neutron is a small magnet. So how do you do, what do you get about the magnetic system? So you can look at a spin arrangement. As I said, it's not the distribution of atoms, but also if these are magnetic materials, so each atom will have a magnetic moment. So how they are arranged in the material? Or how these spins, they vibrate in a system. So what kind of dynamics they have? And in fact, Professor Sul, who got the Nobel Prize, this was one of the early works. as early as 1949 to so that neutron can give you chemical as well as magnetic structure. So here you can see a scattering pattern when you have a sample at a temperature above nil temperature. Above nil temperature means these moments will be decoupled, actually. They will become non-magnetic above nil temperature, and there you have these kind of patterns. But if you go below nil temperatures, where now they get ordered, actually, these spins will get ordered. And in that case, you can see that you have number of extra peaks, actually. So that is coming because you are also looking at magnetic structure now. Not only the chemical structure, but also magnetic structure. And this is the beauty of neutron, actually. And you have a lot of applications in magnetism and magnetic materials. As you know, that magnetic materials are used for power devices and for storage devices. And once you know their magnetic properties, you can enhance their properties for the set applications. The another unique application of neutron scattering is to look at low Z elements. So the complementary techniques to neutron is X-rays. And in the case of X-rays, your scattering depends on the Z. Z means number of electrons in the atom. So hydrogen is hardly seen by the X-rays. It is very, very difficult. But if you see scattering power of neutron for different elements, so you can see, because its scattering is from the nucleus, so you can also see the light element like hydrogen. And that's what happens. I mean, if you are seeing a protein in case of X-rays, you miss the completely the hydrogens, and which you can see. This is benzene ring in a protein structure. And you can see these hydrogen by the neutron scatterings. So this is used for protein crystallography and drug design. And then this technique is very, very important, contrast variation. As I said, you can make invisible visible, and also you can simplify multi-component system. You can see core cell only as a core and a cell. And for this, the reason is different isotopes, because different isotopes means their nuclei will be different. And once their nuclei will be different, and neutron scattering is from the nucleus, and their scattering amplitudes will be very different. And you can mix H2O D2 to get a color, to get a scattering power, which is in this case similar to the cell. And then you only see the core. And in this case, your scattering power, you can mix H2 and D2 so that your scattering power of the solvent is same as that of the core, and you will only see the cell. So this is very much done in the case of number of soft matter and biological systems. And then another application where you can use neutron scattering is to look at thin films and multilayers. So when you make a thin film with two material A and B, then you can see that you can have different kind of interface depending on what you choose of the materials. And this can be distinguished by your reflectivity measurements, what kind of interface is formed in these kind of thin films. And as I said, one of the advantages of neutron is you only not look at chemical structure, but also magnetic structure. And in that case, you can also see the chemical ordering as well as magnetic ordering by neutron scattering. And this is used a lot in energy and electronics. This is another example where you look at the flux lines in the type 2 superconductors. So what happens? You may be knowing a little bit of this. So if you have a superconductors, then the magnetic field lines, they are expelled from the superconductors. And in case of conductors, they just pass through these. But there will be one phase which is called mixed state or vortex phase, where they can pass through the superconductor, but they will be quantized. So they will be quantized in bundles. And neutron has been useful to measure these flux lines, and also again unique probe, because these flux lines are magnetic and neutron is also magnetic. Because of their magnetic interactions, you can look out the distribution of these flux lines in the superconductors. And this is another applications where you're looking at the dynamics, different kind of dynamics in the system. And as I said, this works because the energy of neutrons and the energy of these mode of vibration, they match, actually. So when two energies, energy of neutron and energy of vibrations are same, so this amount of energy gain and loss by neutrons, you can see by the neutron scattering. And
and these vibrations, they control electrical and thermal conduction. And once you know these, then you can make use of these properties in wide range of materials which are used for energy and functional materials. So basically, when you want to use neutron as a probe for material characterization, so what is your aim? Actually, you are trying to search for a new material or improving the property of existing material. This is the aim you start with as a researcher. And once you are doing this, then you looking at the properties of material. You are studying the properties of material. Have you improved the properties? Have you got the unusual properties or advanced properties of the material? So if you have got so, or if you have not got also, then you want to understand what is happening at atomic level. So how the atoms, molecules, they are arranged or vibrating. So for that, characterize from materials by number of techniques, and a strong case of using neutron scattering. I must say that because you need to have a powerful neutron source for doing neutron scattering. So it is not that you have a material, you immediately go to neutron source. They will never increase this. What they want is you characterize this by number of techniques. Only when you have a strong case to do the neutron scattering, when you have already enough information about your samples, then only you think that you should make use of neutron scattering. And once you have done this, and then you look for the structure property correlation. So whatever better property you get, or even you want to further improve this, has to have structural information. So once you have understood what is there inside the material, then only you can control the property, and that's what you do in the neutron scattering. And then, of course, this is one of the last slides that when you talk about neutron science, it is for different disciplines, from doing fundamental science to advanced technology. And you can see, I mean, from physics to material science, biology, soft matter, chemistry, all these different disciplines, they make use of these neutron science. And then topic they cover all are recent topics like drug discovery, biotechnology, nanostructures, energy, all those kind of topics are covered. And you know, these are relevant to the field like health, food, energy, industry, communication, transport, and all those. When you work on neutron science, you work on one of these fields. So the take home message from this lecture is that neutron scattering is a powerful technique to characterize structure and dynamics of wide range of materials. And why do you do this? It's leading to advancement in science and technology. And then the purpose is to look materials at wide length scale and also dynamics at wide time scales. And why neutron is unique? Because it can see low Z elements, it can see magnetic structures, it can look at thermal excitation, and also uniquely you can make use of contrast variation and so on. So thank you for your kind attentions. And if you want to learn more about neutron scattering, so we have this brochure made, which is available at this site. So you can go through this. So details are given there. And always you can, if you have any information required, you can always contact me. And I am sure that many of you will take science as a career, and some of you will then get opportunity to do neutron science and also visit us. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. ऐसा लग रहा था कि आप बोलते जाओ और हम ज्ञान लेते जाए, क्योंकि मेन हाईलाइट ऑफ योर लेक्चर इज इतने सरल तरीके से आपने ये विषय सामने पेश किया, क्योंकि विषय बहुत गहन है, टेक्निकलिटी बहुत है, लेकिन जिस तरह से आपने पेश किया तो मुझे ये ऐसा प्रतीत होता है कि बच्चों ने भी बहुत खूब उसमें से ज्ञान लिया होगा और एंजॉय किया होगा. राइट फ्रॉम न्यूट्रॉन स्कैटरिंग, व्हाट इज स्कैटरिंग, व्हाट आर डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ स्कैटरिंग, ये इससे लेके आपने एप्लीकेशन तक पूरा जर्नी हमारे सामने पेश किया. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. आसवाल साहब, तो फ्रेंड्स हमारे साथ जुड़े रहेंगे, आपके कुछ क्वेश्चंस रहेंगे तो ग्रुप पे पोस्ट कीजिए, मैं आसवाल साहब को वो क्वेश्चन आपकी तरफ से पूछूंगा और वो आपके क्वेश्चन के जवाब देंगे। तो आप जरूर आपके क्वेश्चंस पोस्ट कीजिए। आसवाल साहब बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, क्योंकि हम लोग तो न्यूट्रॉन स्कूल सेक्शन में दो ही जगह पढ़ते हैं। वैसे जो आपने कहा कि फिशन प्रोसेस में जो न्यूट्रॉन कंट्रोल करने की बात आती है, और दूसरा थोड़ा पहले उससे जेम्स चैडविक ने 1932 को न्यूट्रॉन डिस्कवर किया, बस ये दो जगह है जहां हमें स्कूल सेक्शन स्कूल सिलेबस में न्यूट्रॉन का जिक्र होता है। लेकिन आपने जिस तरह से न्यूट्रॉन को भी स्ट्रक्चर है, न्यूट्रॉन में भी कई सारे क्वार्क्स है, ये तो स्कूली बच्चों के लिए तो बहुत बड़ी अचरज की बात होगी। और बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। ये सारे आई से इट्स अ जर्नी, इट्स अ टूर, इन फैक्ट वर्ल्ड ऑफ न्यूट्रॉन्स यू हैव डिस्प्लेड इन फ्रंट ऑफ अस। थैंक यू वेरी मच सर। नाउ वी विल गो टू आवर अनदर लेक्चर, एंड दैट इज इक्वली इंटरेस्टिंग, बिकॉज नाउ यू नो दैट एटम इज एवरीवेयर, सब जगह होता है। कौन सब जगह होता है ऐसा क्वेश्चन पूछे तो एटम सब जगह होता है। तो इस एटम के बारे में ज्यादा जानकारी साइंटिस्ट अभी भी खोज रहे हैं, उसके बारे में रिसर्च हो रहा है। और क्यों ज्यादा जानकारी खोज रहे हैं, क्योंकि इसके एप्लीकेशन भी बहुत सारे हैं, खाली एटम के नहीं, एटम के अंदर जो पार्टिकल्स है जैसे न्यूट्रॉन है उनके भी बहुत सारे एप्लीकेशन है। यही आपने अभी इस लेक्चर में देखा। अभी जो दूसरा लेक्चर हम पेश करने जा रहे हैं वो है एटम फॉर आवर हेल्थ एंड एग्रीकल्चर। और ये लेक्चर देने के लिए, प्रेजेंटेशन देने के लिए दूसरे साइंटिस्ट बीएआरसी के हमारे साथ जुड़े हैं, जिनका नाम है डॉक्टर जयंत जोशी। जोशी साहब आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत, और हमें खुशी है कि आप एटम के बारे में थोड़ा ज्यादा जानकारी हमारे बच्चों के साथ साझा करेंगे। बिफोर डॉक्टर जोशी सर स्टार्ट्स हिज प्रेजेंटेशन, आई वुड लाइक टू इंट्रोड्यूस हिम। डॉक्टर जयंत जोशी डिड एमएससी फिजिक्स फ्रॉम यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ पुणे, एंड देन ही डिड पीएचडी फ्रॉम बाबा एटॉमिक रिसर्च सेंटर इटसेल्फ। At present, Dr. Joshi is working as an engineer at UGC-DIE Consortium for Scientific Research at Bhabha Atomic Research Center, that is BRC, Mumbai. He is also working as Honorary Secretary of Marathi Vigyan Parishad. Marathi Vigyan Parishad is an NGO working in the field of communicating science, particularly in Maharashtra state. Also, he is a Joint Secretary of Vigyan Bharati, Kokan Prant, Mumbai. He has worked for Astronomy Olympiad examinations at Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education. He is actively involved in science communication for last 25 years or so. He has authored several articles related to science in various newspapers and periodicals. और बहुत interesting बात मैं आपके साथ share करना चाहता हूँ। हर एक scientist में एक बच्चा होता है, एक child होता है। और जोशी सर की एक खास बात मैं शेयर करना चाहता हूँ। ही इज हैविंग अ फॉन्ड ऑफ कलेक्टिंग टॉयज। ही हैज गॉट थाउजेंड्स ऑफ साइंटिफिक टॉयज एंड गेम्स एंड पजल्स इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स इन हिज कलेक्शन। एंड उनका एक शो रहता है, बहुत अच्छा शो रहता है, और कई घंटे मुझे मालूम है वो ये शो कर सकते हैं। इतना बड़ा उनके पास खिलौनों का कलेक्शन है, और वो खिलौने कैसे चलते हैं, कैसे काम करते हैं, और उसके पीछे क्या साइंस है वो ये बताते हैं इन शो के दरमियान। सो ही हैज गॉट स्पेशल इंटरेस्ट इन कम्युनिकेटिंग साइंस इन दैट वे। ऑल्सो ही हैज गॉट स्पेशल इंटरेस्ट इन टीचिंग लर्निंग साइंस विथ लोकली अवेलेबल मटेरियल। आप जो कुछ मटेरियल आपके घर में हो उनसे भी बहुत सारे एक्सपेरिमेंट्स कर सकते हो, इसके बारे में भी वो कम्युनिकेट करते हैं और वो लोगों को ज्ञान देते हैं। He has delivered more than 200 lectures and some 500 plus lecture demonstrations of these scientific experiments in various schools, colleges and in public gatherings. So his work is spread all over India, and he is very much active in various organizations in communicating science. Now today he will be talking with us regarding ATOM. So I would like to invite Dr. Jayant Joshi to present his topic, ATOM for our health and agriculture. But before he presents, just a simple request that students, if you have any doubts, if you have any questions, you can post those questions on WhatsApp group. I will ask the questions to all these regarding all these topics to these scientists on behalf of you. So over to you, Joshi sir, floor is yours.
Thank you, Hemant, and I thank organizers for giving me this opportunity to interact with students. I would like to be a bilingual because I know there are some people from interior of India, and also I would short of time, and I'm happy that Dr. Kalyan Rao and Dr. Aswal has made my life a little easier, because they have already explained that production of neutrons and how that mutation and the modification in DNA is takes place. So without wasting much time, I will start my presentation. I hope you can see. Whenever you talk about atomic energy, then normally these pictures are shown. Means whether it is to Fukushima or anywhere in the world, whatever happens, the Doordarshan and other TV channels show this picture. And when you see this picture, in general, what we see is this mushroom cloud, which is a destructive thing for atomic energy, this destructive approach of atomic energy. But it's not so. We always say that we break the atom for the service of the nation. Rashtra ki seva mein parmanu, atom for the service of the nation. And Dr. Homi Bhabha, who is the architect of Nuclear India, but I will request you students, although I am not going to talk much about Dr. Bhabha, he was a very nationalist person, and he has a couple of very famous letters. You must read about his autobiography. He wrote a letter to this Tata Group, and he also a letter to his father. These letters are very famous letter. When some opportunity comes, I may talk about that, but you should try to get this letter and see his approach towards the science and also nation. So I have given this little bit details about it, his birthplace, birth date, and his family background. But you must read about it. This Bhabha Atomic Research Center, if you just Google on Google Earth, you will find something like it's close to a sea, and the other side it's a hill. So it is in between hill and sea. It's a very very good site and very safe. You can see here all around it is covered with green jungle. And if you see a aerial view, this is the Cyrus reactor. By the side, this dome-like structure is Cyrus, as Dr. Aswar has already told. And this is this rectangular thing is Dhruva, and this long thing which you see is supposed to be the longest building in Asia, which is called modular laboratory. Oh, see, this is again Cyrus. You can see here Cyrus dome. We will come to the main objective of today's lecture. This is when you say atomic energy, it has many facets. You can use it for electricity, health, water, food preservation, environmental thing, national security, technology, industry, and there are different aspects. But this I have enlisted all this, but today we are going to see only this health and agriculture. Of course, fundamental research part is already discussed by Dr. Aswal, that too is the only part of the fundamental research. There are many other aspects of the fundamental research which are not covered. When we see the neutrons, when in your school life, when you learn about this atom, we are always told that it has a nucleus, it has a protons and neutrons inside, and electrons are revolving in different energy levels. But it is much more beyond that. Even inside the atom, this proton and neutron are also, they have also have some subatomic particles. But we will not go in details of that. But particularly heavy elements, the heavy elements are very important for as far as atomic energy thing is concerned. And you always talk about heavy water. Just now, Dr. Aswal talked about D2O. D2O is just a deuterium, that is a heavy water. And when people listen these words, heavy elements, heavy water, then it appears that the subject is also very heavy. And that is misconception, actually. There is a lot of confusion, afraidness, curiosity. As Dr. Aswal told, this is a chain reaction. And when you bombard a neutron on this heavy atom, like uranium, then it will create two byproducts. They will also create a few more neutrons and a lot of energy. And this, if this chain reaction is not controlled, then it becomes an atom bomb. When it is controlled, that is a nuclear reactor. So to control that reactor, we have different mechanisms. We have cadmium or a boron rod, and with that we absorb the neutrons so that to control the nuclear reaction. That is chain reaction. So we have about 27 organizations all over, spread all over the country. I will not spend much time, but you should know your respective state, there is some or other organization which is linked to Department of Atomic Energy. And I have just listed this is the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, which controls all over the activities of radiation related things in India. And there are BARC and Atomic Minerals and Rajaramana Center for Advanced Technology at Indore, VECC at Kolkata, IGCAR at Kalpaka. So all these institutes are there. And there are some institutes like TIFR, Science Institute of Nuclear Physics. They are all basically for basic research. Dr. Aswal has already talked about APSARA. Basically, it is a pool type, swimming pool type reactor, and it was the first nuclear reactor in Asia. I will not talk about much about the technical details of that. And it was inaugurated by then Prime Minister Sri Jawaharlal Nehru. And after that, we came the second reactor, that is CIRUS, Canada-India Research Reactor. That is also 40 megawatt, and it was in collaboration with Canadians. And then the next came to the 100 megawatt reactor, which is totally indigenous, built by Indian scientists and engineers. And this is where all the most of the research related activities are concentrated in BRC on this reactor. Now I will go to the this isotopes. Actually, you must have studied in your school or college days that isotopes are two or more types of atoms. They have same atomic number. Atomic number is same, but the number of neutrons are different. So that's called in Hindi or in Marathi, it is called samasthanike. Means their unka sthan jo hota hai wo periodic table mein wahi rehta hai, lekin unke jo nucleus hai, nucleus ke andar jo number of protons rehte hai wo same rehte hai, lekin number of neutrons jo rehte hai wo alag alag rehte hai. Isliye aur unka jo hai, these atoms also called radioisotopes, emit different types of radiation. And the radiation, which either consists of particle such as electron, neutron, or proton, or like X-rays, gamma rays, it is a workhorse for many technologies. These technologies have many applications in the field of agriculture, medicine, industry, and other areas. the nuclear reactor provides a good source of neutrons, and radioisotopes are produced by irradiating different chemical elements by neutrons. These radioisotopes differ in the kinds of radiation, that alpha, beta, and, or gamma, and they emit the energies and radiation and the specific activity, that is the number of nuclei decaying per second, depend on their what is the which is what is the that particular isotope. They also have large number of application in different fields. So the production of isotopes started in particularly at BRC with the Apsara in 1956, and then at Cyrus it was a little bit more. But in there is something called radiological laboratory, which was started in 70s in BRC. After that, when Dhruva came in picture, after Dhruva started, it improved a lot, and that quantity also, there was a quantum jump, and because of that, we could provide these isotopes to different part of the country. There are over around 100 plus isotopes which are now obtained, and they are the byproducts of research reactors. These are actually, they are not power reactors, or Dhruva, Cyrus, or Apsara, they are not power reactors, they are research reactors. And sources of this higher specific activities, they are produced at this power reactor. So they have their own importance in this different fields. So this is the, at the Dhruva, we have a radiation facility. You can see it is a remote handle. This person who is handling, it's a remote handle, and that yellowish panel which you see, it is a glass, it is a transparent glass, which is a shield. It is a radioactive shield, that radiation cannot come out of that, but that person can see the, and he handles the that those isotopes, and they are packed in a particular shielding and sent to different hospitals and different laboratories. And even we have exported, or even rather now also we export many of the isotopes to different countries. So I will switch over to the atom for health. Means atom, basically this radioisotope we use for two purposes in health. This is the first is diagnosis, and there is a pharmaceutical, that means treatment, what for we use. Let's start for diagnosis, that is what for we use. There are some diseases where these isotopes are very important. These isotopes are used for diagnostic, they are diagnostic tools in medicine as a strong radiation source for treatment of various forms of cancers and tumors. The radiation medicine, that RMC, that the division of BRC, which is it works in BRC also, and it has another extension counter at Tata Memorial Hospital, and it's the foremost institute in the field of nuclear medicine in Southeast Asia. When a particular isotope is administered to a patient, it is selectively absorbed by components that are specific to that particular affected tissues. When the detector scans that particular part of the body, then you will get the idea what exactly is the wrong inside that particular area. And these techniques are used for scanning liver, brain, thyroid, and even we have developed some lung ventilation study using a dry aerosol delivery system, and they are used for pulmonary disease. That also is developed by BRC. There is something called this, you can see this is a camera which scans the human body. And then you can detect a particular type of cancer, and even for thyroid purpose also, they have different cameras, and also they are treated by some radiological medicines. This is a Bhabha Tron. Basically, as I told, एक इंजेक्शन दिया जाता है विच इज द रेडियोलॉजिकल लिक्विड फॉर्म एंड देयर इज अ कैमरा मींस इनिशियली दोज यूज्ड टू बी वेरी स्मॉल कैमरा बट नाउ दे आर ऑल डिजिटल कैमरास एंड यू कैन स्कैन द बॉडी पार्ट एंड यू कैन सी वेयर दैट पर्टिकुलर रेडियो एक्टिव लिक्विड इज गोइंग इन अ बॉडी अफकोर्स इट इज अ वेरी डायल्यूट रेडियो एक्टिव एंड वेरी सेफ as I am going to tell about that in the next few slides. It's very safe and with that we can detect or rather than diagnose the what exactly the problem in the body. Of course, BRC has also developed many such gadgets for like a tele-ECG machine which can be taken very easily with the portable machine and that can be taken anywhere very easily. And for treatment purpose, there's something called brachytherapy. And that brachytherapy, actually, if you see that particular human cells are basically basic units of a living organism. And all tissues made up of cells, an adult human body consists of about 1014 cells. The cells of different tissues have different sizes and shapes. All cells contain the central nucleus with the exception of a red blood cell, which is surrounded by a viscous liquid called cytoplasm. The nucleus contains chromosomes, which constitute an array of genes. The chromosomes control all functions of the cell and turn the tissues. The cells originate or multiply from existing cells by producing the cell division. When the radiation passes through the body, the radiation transfers some energy to the cells, and by that means it creates the ionization and excitation, which in turn lead to the variety of chemical changes. Generally, these chemical changes causes harm to the cells. But depending on the seriousness of the and the harm of the cell, dies and gets modified, and that's how you can treat the particular disease. And in certain cases, we can modify those cells to for particular purpose. And these are the different activities. This particular thing is a radio immunosurgery. It is a radioanalytical technique with remarkable sensitivity and high degree of specificity that is widely used for estimation of variety of molecules present in the complex matrix. The application of this technique spans over the wide spectra of substances such as hormonal disorder, steroid, vitamins, drugs. For all these purposes, these techniques are used. There are some machines which are basically use sterilization of the radiological product, medical products. Basically, our traditional methods are chemical methods or some heat treatment methods are there. And these methods actually are the surface method. That doesn't go to the bulk of the material. But the radiation, it can go to the bulk of the material and it will sterilize the thing from interior. So that's why this is now very popular for sterilization. For laser, there are some this laser also used by which is fabricated or in a BRC or CAT indoor. There are some carbon dioxide lasers. They are also used by different hospitals. This is laser is again developed by CAT in TMC. That the Tata. Memorial Hospital, this linear accelerators are developed by BRC and they are regularly used at TMC. This blood irradiation means, as I told, for sterilization, we have a different traditional method, but you can irradiate blood also, and particularly it is by gamma rays. It has a very high penetration. so we can treat it or preserve it for longer time. And this has a very positive effect that you can preserve it for longer time. Cancer awareness camps are also regularly conducted by Tata Memorial Center, and that is also part of outreach activity of this BRC, or rather Department of Atomic Energy. This is the advanced center for treatment of research and education in cancer, which is at Navi Mumbai, Kharghar. And all these isotopes are used, which are prepared at BASC, and they are used here. And most of the hospitals in India, they use these isotopes, which are created or produced in BASC. As in the morning, it was told that agriculture is our culture. And let me tell you, it is the backbone of our economy. As it was also mentioned in the morning lecture, that all other things were locked down, but the agriculture or farming was not locked down. And it is a continuous process. And for agriculture also, we use atom for two different purposes, for breeding new seeds, and then there's something called post-harvest, that is after producing particular product, how to preserve it. So I will talk about how the new breeds are there. Of course, in the morning, Kalyan Rao Patil also talked about that, how this DNA modification is done, and with that, how we can improve the with the mutation, how we can improve the genes in particular seeds. Basically, genetic improvement of crop plant is a continuous endeavor. The yield, matlab, how much output you get, that quality of the product, or the tolerance of the crop to the stress factors, like you may not get there's some famine, or some sort of there's a stretch of water, you don't have enough water, then that your crop should be able to face all these problems. Or there are some insects or pests to control that, the adverse environmental condition, that needs to be a constant improvement to meet the changing demands of the society. The process in breeding the crop plants depends upon the selection of the favorable combinations of the characters available in the population. The heritable variants occur spontaneously in all living organisms and are largely due to the mutation of the genes. The frequency of mutation can be greatly enhanced by exposing seeds and other plant parts to the radiation. Radiation-induced mutation enhances the range of variability from which the plant breeds can select and combine different desired characteristics to produce better crop plants. Using this approach, improved varieties of pulses, groundnuts, mustard, rice, jute, they have been developed at BRC, and there are different aspect of this which are looked into. This groundnuts, they are the new varieties produced are they give more yield, they are they can sustain for longer stretch of water shortage, and many other aspects are taken care in this. There is something called micropropagation of sugarcane, that the tissue culture method, that is also developed by BRC, and it gives more yield. Similarly, there are more for banana, that micropropagation of banana by tissue culture method, and it also give, there are various additional features or benefits which you get with this tissue culture method. We get more yield, they have high resistance to the diseases, and longer shelf life. You can see that yield is more, that urid, which is a black gram, that also is a that mutated versions of the urid seeds are discovered or newly generated by BRC, and this rice also new breeds are discovered by BRC scientists, and they give again that all more yield, and they are very resistant to the different diseases. Different seeds are again this technology is transferred to the different agencies. This is the Mahiko Mahabij, which was mentioned in the morning, which is at Jalna in Maharashtra. This when the technical know-how is given to the different agencies, they produce it in a mass production, and it is given to the farmers of the respective states. There is a jute to improve the soil quality. That also BRC has come up with a new variety of jute. This manure which is at Trombe. So groundnut gives a high yielding and improved quality. This pigeon pea, that high yielding, disease resistant, early maturing period, and improved quality. That black gram, which is urid, that it's again high yield and disease resistant. That moong also high yield and disease resistant. Rice, mustard, jute, they are all basically it gives high yielding and improved quality and fiber yielding. So this again same thing. See this pineapple also is a new variety of pineapple is also developed by this tissue culture method, which is also which gives more yield. This another this is a collaboration with different agricultural universities. If you see this this resistant sweet potato was developed by Central Tuber Crop Research Institute, Thiruvananthapuram, and some similar projects were taken by Board of Research in Nuclear Sciences with Baba Saheb Ambedkar Marathwada University, and they have also developed some of the new seeds or new varieties. After post harvesting, basically, as I told, we have isotopes, and those isotopes, these materials are exposed or for a certain time, and the dose is also controlled by different ways, and they do different experiments. And after optimizing those parameters, that duration and dose, they come up with a certain up to optimized parameter, which are used for irradiating these samples or agricultural products. You can see the this is onion, which is irradiated, and that left side is irradiated, and this right side is non-irradiated, and you can see the sprouting very easily. The potato also same thing. If they are not irradiated, you will find the sprouting. These are chilies and some turmeric. These products are also you can extend its life, or you can also prolong its ripening period by irradiation. The irradiation process slows down the ripening of the fruits. The picture, as I already mentioned, prolongs the sprouting. Some food items, fruits are also. See, this is the that Alfonso. Let me tell you. The person which you see here at the rightmost, he was Dr. Banerjee, Sri Kumar Banerjee, who was the chairman of Atomic Energy Commission, and last night only he took his last breath. But he was very instrumental in popularizing this radio technologies in country. This particular picture is exporting Alfonso mango, which is very special from Konkan area of Maharashtra. This were exported. These are the irradiated samples, and it was this particular picture was taken at the U.S. embassy. Certain species, spices are also irradiated to prolong its life by gamma irradiation. This is the picture of a irradiation plant which is located at Lasalgaon in a Nasik district of Maharashtra. At Vashi also, we have a 500 kV KEV industrial accelerator of BRC, and that gives actually 20 tons per day spices are irradiated in this plant. So it has a big boom for spice exports. These are some pictures of those centers, which is, one is at Lasalgaon, which is known as Krushak. Mainly it is for onion irradiation, and this lower picture is from Navi Mumbai, Vashi plant. There is something called BRIT, Board of Radiation and Isotope Production. They also supply, they also have their own irradiation plant, and they also supply the isotopes. So Nisargaguna is another project. Basically, we although it's not directly related to the isotopes, but this also is very, how can you improve the whatever you get from agricultural waste, how you can use for production of electricity, not electricity, for production of gas. And you can see there are some solar panels which aggravate the process of the composing. Let me go, now I will move towards the end of my lecture. You can see this picture in most of the urban part of the country. You will find this picture, and people celebrate a lot of many festivals. And at the same time, there in some part of the country, you will find this picture. Let me tell you, this picture I have taken a few months back at the Mankur station, which is very close to the BARC. This picture was taken at 1 a.m. in the morning. And you can see the students are studying at railway station because they don't have proper infrastructure, they don't have electricity at their home. So you believe or not, this is the reality. So to conclude, the application of radiation technology, the earlier slide I showed, because although it is not covered in my topic today, that is this atom for electricity generation, but electricity generation is also, that power generation is also important aspect of nuclear energy. The application of radiation technology to healthcare, industry, food and agriculture are the direct benefits of the society, and DAE is working for all aspects. Production of supply of the source of radiation, use of radiation for known application, and research and development aim at acquiring new application, design and manufacture of equipment and plants to facilitate use of radiation technologies and deployment of such technologies in the country. We are now trying to reach production as well as user agencies for wider deployment of such technologies so as to provide larger benefit to the society and make higher contribution to the health and prosperity of our people. To anticipate, you will find the Government of India has several staff for atomic energy, and Dr. Bhumi Baba. This just to give, you know, another minute, I will finish. Many of you may not have been born before 1998, but you must read about, there is something called Pokhran nuclear test, and India conducted its first nuclear test in 1974. Then second in 1998. That's why we celebrate our National Technology Day on 11th of May. And that time all over the world, it was assumed that it is an earthquake. But then Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee came and they declared that it's not the earthquake, it's the nuclear test conducted by India. And these are the people, you may not recognize them, but they are all in military dress, but they are all scientists. You can see Dr. Abdul Kalam, Dr. Chidambaram, Dr. Kakorkar, Santayam. These are all the people. And there was a wave of nationalism in the country just because of the science. And after those tests, there were many many sanctions were put on India. These financial sanctions that we will not give this thing, we will not give that cryogenic things, we will not give proper supercomputers. But all these problems were overcome by Indian scientists, and they found their own ways to address this problem. So let me tell you, what is this? Why do we exercise? We exercise to keep ourselves healthy. It's not necessary that you should go and fight with somebody, but to keep yourself healthy, you need to exercise. This, you can see, what is this? This is a ruler, or this is a scale which we use, but teacher use it for drawing lines. But when situation demands, teacher also warn with this scale. And when situation demands, it is used for the giving proper lesson to the student. Same is the thing for atomic energy. We also have to have our national safety, we use nuclear energy. And that's the reason you see the people who put sanction all on us, they started coming to India and meeting our prime minister. I mean, the person, people kept changing, but you can see different people came and they met different prime ministers who were there and who are there right now. But my ultimate aim, message to tell is the nuclear energy is the shield for the country. And if you want to build a nation very strong, you need to have this shield. So when and I will conclude with this. See, this is there's a very famous verse in Sanskrit. Nabhisheko na samskara sinhasta kriyate vane. Vikramarjita sattvasya svayameva mugendata. Miss lion never tells that, nobody goes and tells that lion is the king of the jungle. Or he has to prove himself that he is the king of the jungle by his deeds. And he performs so, that's why people accept him as a king. So that's why if no other person will come or third person will come and tell that you people are developed country, we ourselves will have to prove that we are a developed country, and I'm sure that many of you will take up science as a career and prove that yes, we are developed country. With this, I thank once again.
Thank you, Joshi sir. As you have rightly said, that we must be on our feet. जो जिसके जिसको हम आत्मनिर्भर कहते हैं वो आत्मनिर्भर होना चाहिए और टू बिकम सेल्फ सफिशिएंट सेल्फ रिलायंट एटॉमिक एनर्जी और द एटॉमिक साइंस इज अ वेरी वेरी इफेक्टिव टूल सो यू हैव ओपन्ड अप द एंटायर स्पेक्ट्रम ऑफ यूज ऑफ एटॉमिक एनर्जी फॉर आवर हेल्थ for agriculture, and also you have talked about how atomic energy can be used for self-sufficiency in energy and of course for our defense purposes. Thank you very much, sir. And now this is the time for answering the queries from the students. So there are many questions, in fact, students have posted. They are very curious, and I would like to ask some of the questions which are relevant to the today's discussion. So, since the lecture is fresh, I would like to ask the first question to Joshi sir on behalf of students, and it is related to, of course, the atom for health and agriculture. Sir, this is the question: that are the new breeds of plants produced by BRC, are they being used for commercial purpose, commercial scale in India, or they are just for the experimental state only?
No, as I told you, actually they are handed over to the respective agencies and they produce it in a on mass scale, and after that they are available in market and they are available for common people, and people can buy that and use it for their own cultivation.
Okay, and another question is regarding health. You have talked about isotopes. So one question is asked by the student that do the isotopes used in diagnosis have any interaction? I think he has to say any effect, not interaction, with the cells of the body which can bring out a change in a genome of the individual. So I think the student wants to clarify whether the isotopes are affecting the genes of our body, the isotopes which are used for diagnostic purpose.
Yes, they do. Actually, any ionizing radiation will penetrate to the body and they will cause the modification in DNA. So specifically, in general, all care is taken for shielding the experimentalist from that. But for particular purpose, deliberately, if you want to do some mutation, then this type of experiments are performed. Of course, they are very controlled experiments, how much dosage to be taken, or how much duration it should be taken. And with that, they conduct many experiments and many clinical trials, and then they come up with the actual thing in the market or in our day-to-day life.
Okay, we'll come to Aswal sir now. Students have asked many questions regarding neutron scattering and all. One question is a very fundamental question, it seems. Does the instability of free neutron help in formation of heavy isotopes of uranium or plutonium during the formation of nuclear energy in nuclear plants?
No, it's not. Neutron is not unstable. Actually, the nucleus becomes unstable. So once neutron-proton ratio changes, then nucleus becomes unstable, and that's what it undergoes fission reactions. So the unstability of neutron, that lifetime of 15 minutes, that is too large for any experiment, because most of the things, they happen in a time scale which is much, much less. So it doesn't matter.
Okay. And just to continue with this, as both electrons and neutrons have magnetic dipole movement, does it have any effect on the stability of an atom? That is the question posted.
No, neutrons are held inside the nucleus. So there the ball game is different. This nuclear interaction is there. And then students may be knowing that atom size is much larger than the nucleus size. So nucleus size is in femtometers. There the driving interactions are very different. And the electrons which are revolving around the nucleus, there the ball game is different. So of course, they will learn all this when they grow up, how the nucleus is held together and how the electrons are revolving without losing energy around the nucleus. So there, this magnetic-magnetic interaction does not play any role. It's only in the scattering, when you have a free neutron interacting with the magnetic atom, then it plays a role of magnetic scattering.
Okay, we have read in the books, we have studied in the books that boron steel and cadmium rods are used to control chain reaction. Also, Joshi sir talked about that. So, Joshi sir, how these materials, cadmium or boron rods, control the reaction in the reactors? That is what the question is asked. What is the exact what is exactly happening there?
Actually, these products have affinity to neutrons, means they can absorb the neutrons. Boron or cadmium, rather the rod of boron rod or cadmium sheet, they are used. Of course, nowadays we have come up with a different technology. We have boronated rubber or boronated plastic. or boronated wood also, boron is enriched in all these materials, and we can have flexible shielding or very rigid shielding. And with that, we can control. Basically, as I told, in the nuclear reaction, that if the primary and secondary ratio goes beyond one, then it becomes atom bomb. So to control that ratio of number of neutrons produced, we insert the rods of this cadmium or boron to absorb the neutrons. And when they absorb the neutrons are means the number of neutrons is limited, and that doesn't go beyond the critical stage. That's how the nuclear reaction is controlled, and that's how actually nuclear reactor is also controlled.
Okay, and now there is a lot of superstitious or some misconceptions in the minds of not only in minds of students but minds of common people also. Something when we call as nuclear radiation, then it is hazardous. That is fixed in the mind, and such questions are many. In fact, they are asked, but we would like to listen to directly from the scientists we ensure that we get first-hand information. So, on behalf of students, I would like to ask one question regarding it. That can food irradiation affect the nutritional value of the vegetables, and can it affect our body when gamma radiation is radiated on our body for cancer treatment? So, I think that the student is a bit confused how you can at the same time radiations, they are saving our life, and how they are killing something which is not that is something which we don't want. So please clarify, Doshi sir.
Yeah, actually it's a very good question, and there are a lot of misconceptions. And as far as the experimentalist health is concerned, you can see Dr. Aswal or myself, we are working there for more than 25 years. So as such, if you take the proper precautions, It's dual-edged sword, Dudhari Talwar. So I say, if you take a proper precaution, there is no hazard at all. But if you are careless, then there is a problem. So you have to be very careful. At the same time, as far as the pharmaceutical aspect of the isotope is concerned, they are very controlled experiments. Or rather control with how much dose is to be taken or given, or how much duration it is to be given. All those things are predetermined, and doctors are trained for that. And not only that, it's not randomly given. It is given at the particular part of the body. And people have done a lot of experiments. Then when you inject, or there are some therapies that you can insert a small capsule in the body which has a radioisotope. It's very tiny, it's not a very big capsule. And that will go to the respective part of the body, and it will damage only those cells which are creating problems. It's not that it will damage all the cells. So all those are clinical trials are taken for that, and then only it comes to the real life. It's not that just like they will do some experiment on common people. It's not like that. So all necessary precautions are taken, and it is totally safe when if it is used properly. If it is not used properly, then it's always, and that is true with every therapy or every, even if you go outside on the road, if you do not follow the rules of the traffic, accident is going to take place. So it's as simple as it.
Okay, there is a question to Aswal sir. Can we identify, sir, various crystal defects using neutron scattering, and if yes, how?
Crystal defects, yes, you can do, because as I said, structures, when you do structures, so structures will give you information about the how the atoms are distributed. So if there are defects, it will reflect in your structure pattern. So you can do it actually by diffraction experiment.
Okay, thank you, sir. We'll take just a couple of questions more and then we will end the session. There are some questions students have asked about moderators. So the moderators that we use in atomic reactor, what is the criteria for selecting a moderator? Anybody can answer.
So moderator, basically what you had, as I said, the energy of the neutron which is produced is in mega electron volt, that is 10 power 6 electron volt. So you have to slow down again to be used for chain reaction. And for that, you will use moderator, which has to be low Z elements. How do you lose the energy? You lose the energy by elastic collision. And the energy loss is maximum when you have the another particle which has the same mass actually. So that's why low Z elements like H2O, D2O, they are used. Only when you have neutral uranium, then you have to use the D2O because their absorption is less. And when you have enriched uranium, where your uranium nuclei, which is undergoing fission reaction, if it's in higher amount, then you can use H2O because then it will be less costly. So enriched uranium, you have to use H2O, and natural uranium, you have to use D2O.
Okay.
It has to be low Z elements.
In continuation with that, one student has asked, sir, graphite is the most commonly used moderator, and if so, then why most of the nuclear power plants have pressurized heavy water reactors, or they use heavy water?
No, actually, graphite is used as a reflector, not as a moderator. So most of these reactors, they will have H2 or D2 as a moderator. So graphite is a reflector, actually.
Okay, and what are heavy water reactors? What is the role of heavy water?
No, as I again said, I mean, if you use heavy water, then it depends on how much enriched uranium you have. Because when you have a neutral uranium, only 0.7% is U-235, which undergoes fission reaction. But if you can enrich it, then you can use H2O. If you are not able to use enrich it in a higher amount, then you use D2O. So that's to have a fission reaction undergoing the chain, you have to make a combination of H2O, D2O with how much enrichment you have. So when you have higher amount of enrichment, then you use D2O. And when you have lower amount of enrichment, then you use D2O.
Okay. Sir, there is another fundamental question hai aapke liye. You have shown elastic and inelastic scattering, neutron scattering. The student has asked, what is the significance of that angle theta?
No, angle theta is very important because, as I said, you look at different length scale. So because as you grow up, you learn actually, when you want to go from the real space where you have atoms distributed to a scattering space where you are getting intensity as a function of angle. So they are related by Fourier transform. So if you have larger objects, then they will come to smaller angles. And if you have smaller objects, they will go to larger angles. So if it means that if you're looking at atoms, then your diffraction pattern will be at higher angular range. If you're looking at larger particles like protein macromolecules, they will go to smaller angles. So this angle plays very, very important role depending on the length scales in the system.
Okay, thank you, sir. One last question I would like to take, very interesting question the student has asked. Doshi sir, please answer this question. Does X-ray scanning of food in airport or in the office harm the food inside the lunch boxes?
Not at all. No, it is very safe. And this actually, if you see the energy of the X-rays which are used there, it's very low. And that doesn't affect the food which is there inside the luggage. We quite often, when we go to office, we scan our bags with X-ray, and it contains our teachings also, but it doesn't make any difference.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now the time is up. I think it is more than 1.5 hours. The session was scheduled for 1 hour, but the interesting discussion was going on. And I thank both of you for giving such a nice information, knowledge, sharing your experiences, sharing some of the photographs which we cannot see openly, what is there inside the reactor and what is exactly people are doing there. So thanks a lot for sharing such a great knowledge with our students. And I hope that we are working like a family in Vidyan Bharati. So you are always with us and we will definitely collaborate with you, call you to guide our students in future also. So thank you very much. Friends, so here we come to the end, and I must acknowledge the efforts in organizing this lecture series. Our subject head, Dr. Vishnu Vaze sir, my colleague, Dr. Nilima Mulgun madam, who coordinated last two sessions, and also the technical team, which is headed by Rajkumar ji. So I thank all the team members, all of you, for participating in this particular and the lecture series, which was there in the morning also. So I come to the end of this series. I hope you have gained a lot through this lecture series. And of course, you are preparing for your national level camp as well. So with this note, would like to say goodbye, take care, remain safe. Jai Hind.